Hi there, and welcome back to this final video masterclass on the management of arrhythmias and anti-arrhythmic drug therapy. In this final part, we'll be looking briefly at the management of bradyarrhythmias. I'd like to just remind you that there are algorithms available online at the Resuscitation Council, and this is what ALS treatments are all based on. So you can download these for free. There's also an app that you can use, so you've got them on the phone should you want them. When we're examining a bradycardia electrocardiographically, we're looking at the heart rate, but also we're looking at the relationship between the P waves and the QRS complexes. And you can see here, irrespective of whether this is complete heart block or secondary degree heart block, that the P waves do not have a one-to-one relationship with a QRS complex. And that's a defining feature that you'll see in patients with heart block. Back in the first of these video masterclasses, we talked about the spectrum of danger for all arrhythmias, and that's true for bradycardias as well. And if we look at this graph, we can see that there are certain features that will be associated with patients being much iller and at higher risk of asystole and death. Over on the left and the green end of the spectrum, we might have somebody with sinus bradycardia and very few symptoms, and their risk is low, and we may not need to treat it at all. But as the degree of block goes higher towards second and third degree heart block, and there have been any of those symptoms such as syncope or shock, then we are increasingly worried that this patient needs emergency treatment. Before we come on to the drugs used to treat bradycardia themselves, it's important to think about what might be driving the bradycardia. And there are three main groups of conditions or situations where bradycardias may arise, and we need to address these as well. The first is the patient on any anti-arrhythmic drugs? It stands to reason that the drugs we've been talking about in the previous masterclasses may cause bradycardia. So beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, digoxin, etc. I'll also mention evabradine, which is not used as an anti-arrhythmic drug. It tends to be used in angina, but this does slow the heart rate down. So that might be one reason you might find that a patient has a bradycardia that's being driven pharmacologically. Secondly, electrolyte disturbances should always be checked, and in particular, a high potassium can exacerbate problems with bradycardia. And finally, always consider whether there's myocardial ischemia or infarction. Certainly patients with acute coronary syndromes may present with bradyarrhythmias as well as tachyarrhythmias. Just casting your mind back to the previous talks as well, if the patient is very ill, we may need to reach for equipment straight away. We'll come back to that. But we'll start off with, you know, what kind of drugs can we use to treat a bradycardia? The parasympathetic nervous system and the sympathetic nervous system are our key targets for managing bradycardia. Starting with the parasympathetic first, because this is the drug that you will use first, you'll be aware that the vagus nerve carries the parasympathetic fibers to the heart and the lungs, and that they, when stimulated, they will cause a decreased heart rate and maybe bronchoconstriction as well. The drug that we can use to antagonize this is atropine. You may be aware that this is found in lots of plants, including things like deadly nightshade. And we can give multiple doses of atropine in 500 microgram aliquots up to a maximum of 3 milligrams to treat a serious bradycardia. So atropine is an antagonist of the parasympathetic nervous system. And so if we administer it as we would want with a patient with bradycardia, we can expect the heart rate to increase. And that's because it's diminishing the tone in the vagus nerve and increasing excitability at the SA node and the AV node, etc. However, there are going to be some side effects that we might expect from that. And those include confusion in the elderly, blurred vision, a dry mouth, and particularly in elderly male patients, we need to be aware that we might also precipitate acute retention of urine. The sympathetic nervous system can also be used to try and speed the heart rate up. Naturally, the sympathetic nervous system, through thoracolumbar efferents, will cause bronchodilation in the lungs and an increased heart rate through stimulation of the SA and the AV node. And that brings us really to this slide that summarizes what we can do in the management of bradycardia. When we first find a patient who with us about bradycardia that definitely needs treating, the quickest thing that we can administer is atropine, and we can give that up to 6 times to a total of 3 milligrams. And that's called a maximum vagalytic dose. But if that doesn't work, or if we really think that this is a bradycardia that's going to cause persistent danger to this patient, we need to be thinking ultimately about equipment. And that's going to be things like a permanent pacemaker if we don't think this is a reversible bradycardia. And in the meantime, we may need to do transcutaneous pacing, external pacing. There is one other treatment that you will see in use, and that uses stimulation of the sympathetic nervous system. We can administer an infusion of either adrenaline, or certainly in the UK more commonly, isoprenaline, and this can sustain a higher heart rate in patients whilst we're looking for more definitive treatments, such as a permanent pacemaker to be arranged. So that's a single slide that really summarizes the management of bradycardia. That kind of brings us to the end of this set of video masterclasses, but we've only really touched the surface, and I've just put a slide together here with a few other topics that you might be interested in looking over in a bit more detail. Firstly, you're not wasting your time at all developing some expertise around the management of atrial fibrillation, because this is really, really common. It's important to look over beta blockers and digoxin in a bit more detail than we've covered here. And there is some nice guidance on AF management that's particularly useful. Also remember that patients with atrial fibrillation and flutter may need anticoagulation depending on their risk scores. Some other conditions you might look around regarding arrhythmias. Wolff-Parkinson-White is a good prototype for reentrant tachycardias. The ALS guidance around resuscitation is useful from the Resuscitation Council. And we haven't touched today on simple things that you might try in an SVT, such as Valsalva maneuvers and carotid sinus massage. Whilst not a drug therapy as such, being able to manage electrolyte disturbances is very useful. So replacement of potassium and magnesium, treatment of hyperkalemia, that kind of thing. And going back to basics and understanding the autonomic nervous system is never a waste in pharmacology. So that's something you could look at. Okay, well, I hope these series of video masterclasses on arrhythmias have been useful. Thank you very much for your attention.